Very good. Now we have the complete knowledge to code experiments, so let's really quickly look at three experiments and the entire code of them to see what we know so far. So at first, we look at an experiment task, and that is an experiment for testing the Simon effect, which says that reaction times are faster and reactions more accurate when the stimulus occurs in the same relative location as the response, even if the stimulus location is irrelevant to the task. So what is the experiment design for this task? Well, in two experimental tasks, participants have to respond to a rectangle on the screen according to its color, which is either red or green, by pressing the left or right arrow key on the computer's keyboard. Additionally, the position of the rectangles can be either left or right. So we have a congruent and an incongruent condition, and in the congruent one, the position of the rectangle is the same as the response key. However, we note that the position is irrelevant to the task, which is an important thing for the Simon to prove the actual Simon effect. This is the basic information, so let's get into more detail how we structure our task. Each trial will start with the presentation of a fixation course for 500 milliseconds, followed by the rectangle that will remain on the display until a response is given. Between trials, a blank screen is shown for 3 seconds. Each block will contain 128 trials in random order, which is why the experiment I showed so far was called Simon Task Short, because there we had only 16 trials, I think. The two tasks will differ only in the mapping of the response, meaning which button to press for which color, which will be shown to the participant as a brief instruction at the beginning of each block. The order of tasks will be counterbalanced over participants. The experiment has a 2x2x2x2 factorial design, with the within subject factors color, position, and task, as well as the in between subject factor task order. Okay, so this here is the paper and where they did that, and I simply copied the code from the paper. So this here is an actual experiment, it is one that tries to show an experiment, but this is an actual experiment as neuroscientists would actually do it. And we see when we create an experiment like this, these are the things we have to think about first. Okay, so we have to think about what is the design we are making, and we see. So we have two different colors, two different positions, and two tasks. And then the task order is different for the participants. So this, I think they just wanted to showcase that they have in between subject factors. But it makes sense to shuffle this probably in between the factors anyway. Okay, so this is the actual experiment. We import a lot of stuff from the experiment package. We don't want the develop mode now, because now we want actual participants. We make sure that we don't output timestamps to the logging file, such that we only show the time after the experiment started here. Yes, then we create a design.experiment, we initialize in our control package, we preload fixed course, blank screen, everything else. We set the response keys, which we have, and then, like I said, we have this 2x2x2x2 design. So we have two mappings, left for green and left for red, which are blocks then. So we create two blocks and add them to the experiment after shuffling them. And the block, so the factor for the block is the mapping. So what differs in between those two blocks is that the one has the mapping left for green and the other has the mapping left for red. And then inside each of these blocks, we have the position where we want to show it, as well as the color of the stimulus. And then we create a trial for this. We set these two factors. So this here is one factor. These are two other factors. So we now have 2x2x2 already. And then we create a stimulus depending on the factors we have so far. We add this, and we add the stimulus to our block, and then we add the trial to the block. Like I said, we add the blocks to the experiment. And then we add additionally the between subjects factor, which is the task order, and depending on this, we will now sort the blocks. Okay, so the blocks are so far in order, first left for green and then left for red. And depending on the subject number, we will switch these two blocks, which is our last by two in our experiment design here. Yes, so we have the data variable names, mapping color, position button, and response time. These are the ones we're going to save to file. And then we also want to save the design to CSV such that we can look at this. So let's look at simondesign.csv. Well, let's look at this in pandas later. But we see here that, well, it saved all of the conditions here and the order is also given. All right, then we start the experiment, and depending on the permuted between subjects factor condition, we may swap the blocks. So this is just like I did in the linguistic experiment I showcased earlier. After code and control.start, we now have the subject number and thus also have the results for getting the permuted between factors condition. And depending on this, for example, in this case, we simply swap blocks such that for every other participant, we're going to show the second block first. Okay, and then inside the actual experiment, what we only do is we loop over all the blocks, but at first we show the instructions, which are different for the blocks because the instructions depend on the mapping here. So we show new instructions for the second block, and then we loop over all the trials in the block and show the stimulus after. So we wait, and we show the stimulus, and then we wait for the response. And now the response we have to add using x.data. And after this here, the experiment is over, so we can call control.end, can even specify a goodbye text here, and afterwards we save the design here together with our subject. So this is the design for this subject, just to make sure that we know the complete task order which this subject got. And then we will also add this here, so if we run this, well, it will show in full screen, and it will run until it's done, and then we'll add the data in the event file. So yeah, this is how the design looks. This is, well, after we ran the experiment, this is how the data and the events file will look. All right. Let's run this once. Do I even have it here? I only have the Simon task short, but I ran this already. So the short one doesn't show in full screen, has shorter instructions, etc. But this is basically the same thing again. Now we can look at what I did in our data file here. And in an event file here. And then concerning PsychoPy, I have two experiments here for you. One of them is the full code for the experiment I showed you earlier for the just notifiable difference for an angle of a grating stimulus. And I didn't show you the logging so far because I stripped it from the PsychoPy tutorial. I won't show it here because there's a perfect explanation at the respective tutorials. So this is taken from an original official PsychoPy tutorial, and it explains every piece of the code here. So I won't explain it, but keep in mind that the logging here is not done the way you would normally do it in PsychoPy, because it simply uses how does it log here? It simply writes to a data file. This is not how we would normally do it in PsychoPy. I don't know why they took it out of this experiment, maybe to make the example easier, but I would definitely recommend to use the PsychoPy logging, which I showed you earlier. So like I said, I won't show the code here, but this is the full code, including however the tutorial originally did the logging. But what I want to show you, and what I hinted at earlier, is the full code for the stoop task from the builder. So in the very first view here at the easy way, I created I looked at this video here and I created the stoop task more or less using the builder. And like I said, in the builder, you're generating actual code. So this here is the builder view. You first show the instructions and then you show a trial a couple of times where you take the data you're using from a CSV file, which you also created. And then if you click the button here, this will automatically create Python code from this. And this here is the resulting Python code. Note that because it was generated algorithmically, there are probably a few things you wouldn't do yourself in here, but the code contains a lot to learn from and to copy to projects you may want to use. So, and also it imports a bunch of stuff, and then this, most of this here I already showed you. So it tries to get as many information as possible. It tries to get the, so first of all, it needs the current directory, because this file is one using the PsychoPy, Wanna is the name of that thing. It will automatically create the file with the respective directory names here by itself. So all the time, if you run this experiment from the Wanna, it will change the strings like this, which is why this can use absolute file names. Normally you wouldn't do so. Okay, and yes, it gets the current PsychoPy version and saves them. You could also get this using what is it? So activate. I'm wondering right now, so it's really slow. PsychoPy. Or you could get it from inside Python by importing PsychoPy and then printing PsychoPy. I hope you can. PsychoPy.version. Yes. So this is how you would get it if you did that in code. And then here it creates a dialogue, and that's really nice that PsychoPy also provides the possibilities to very quickly and easily create dialogues to get interaction from the user. And I actually run this code. So it's stoop/stoop.py. Let's run stoop/stoop.py. And well, now I can enter my name, Chris number 3. And then, hope I can still record this. So it will show me welcome, it waits for my key press, and then I think I have to press, I don't know which keys correspond to which color. This you would normally have added as instructions, but I didn't follow the video too well. But yeah, you can create a dialogue from dictionary here. Where I can enter participant and session number here using from a dictionary. If I had more dictionary keys and values in here, I could let the user add more information. I don't know, gender, age, whatever. And then I'm getting many information such that I can save them, because if I add this extra info here to my experiment handler, this will automatically make a column in my resulting file where it saves all of these information here. And yes, then I already showed you this, we already looked at this. This is simply for the loop, so a flag. And if we want to quit the experiment, then we set up the window using psychopy.visual.window with many arguments. We add the frame rate to our experiment info. Like I said, it makes sense to get as many information as possible. So we also try to get the frame rate from the screen. We create a default keyboard. We create a clock. Normally, if you have, for PsychoPy, it recommends to use two clocks. One which, well, no, this is just instruction clock, but normally you have one global clock to track the time since the experiment started, and then another clock to track the time remaining for each loop or each whatever a routine is. Yes, and then here, so these are the components for the instructions. We create a clock, we create a text stimulus, which contains the text I wrote in the builder, which is nonsense as we see. And then we also preload everything for the routine trials. So we do this before the actual experiment starts, such that we minimize instructions throughout the actual experiment loop, such that the actual experiment loop has as precise timing as possible. So we create the clocks, create the text, etc., etc. This here then prepares the start routine instructions. So also the comments are made from the builder interface, so I didn't add the comments, so it's really nice that it adds these kind of columns. We add a bunch of instructions here, and I think eventually we are also adding all of this stuff to our data file. And then yes, we were setting timers. This here is also in part PsychoPy making sure that timing is precise. So as I told you at length already earlier, PsychoPy makes sure to include display refresh rates, etc., etc., in the timing. So this, I think, somehow makes precise timing. And then, yes, this is the instructions routine, and while it's running, which here is true so far and only false if we press escape or something else. It shows this stuff here. It adds its own loop, so it adds its own variables to control the loop. So we had not started or started. It waits for a key press. It flips the screen, etc., etc. It checks if we quit using the escape key. It checks if our components has finished, and then eventually it refreshes the screen, and then we are in the loop until we press whatever the button we press to need for the instructions to show. I think I did something wrong here and I showed the instructions only for a certain time and then waited anyway for the key press. Normally I would have to press, I would have to show the text, the length of the text would have to be infinite. So this is my text stimulus. Now I think I'm not making sure this text is shown for the entire time. Could change this inside the code here. I think it specifies here at which time the text will show, right? Or at which time the text will stop to show. So we would have to make sure that the text will show all the time. But yeah, we get out of this loop once we press the button anyway. And then we're saving a lot of information to our experiment using addData, such that I don't know why we would need the information how long the user looked at the instructions, but more information is better. So let's just do it. Let's reset our routine timer afterwards, and then we are in the actual trials. And these trials use these two conditions.csv, which we created manually, which contains all the conditions for our stoop task. So we simply have word, color, if word and color are congruent, and what the correct answer would be. So if the color was red, the correct answer is left. If the color was green, the correct answer would be down. And we use this CSV using data.interpret conditions for our trial handler. We add the loop to our experiment, and then we loop over all the trials, and inside this we basically continue the stuff we showed already before from the instructions. We make sure that a lot of stuff is locked, etc., 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 etc. And then, so we would be getting here once the user, the participant, pressed some kind of button. And then afterwards we add a lot of data again, also if the response was correct or not, which is the one important thing basically for the stoop task here, right? Additionally to the response time. And then we flip the screen again to make sure that we don't show anything, and we save everything, we close everything, and that's it. So even if we create the experiment in the builder, we create valid Python code, which we could change afterwards.